morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everybody. My name is Sandy Hart, and along with Patricia Fero and Ann Smith, and on behalf of Sarah, the Spiritual and Religious Alliance for Hope, I want to welcome you to this very special Death Throes of Patriarchy call. I'm going to make this introduction very, very quick, since we have four amazing women, each in their own unique way, sharing their wisdom through the lens with which they live and experience the world. Their complete bios are found on our website, and a recording of the call will be sent to you along with a link to get back to their bios very easily, and also how to reach them. We have a very special addition to our call today. Leah Myers is an amazing artist who will be listening really carefully to the energetic imprint of the call, and that will result in an art piece, which you'll also see parts of perhaps even before the call ends. This call is in a sacred circle, and it's going to be moving. You're going to be experiencing a sacred circle, and in the sacred circle, it'll be moving from one speaker to the next, each passing the symbolic talking stick. As we go through and around our circle, then it'll be passed to you once we open our circle to invite you to pick up the talking stick if you would like to do that. Please keep yourself muted during this call, of course. And once again, thank you for being here at in this very special call. And I want to now call on our elder medicine woman and grandmother Sasa to open our call for us today.
Thank you. It is an honor to be with everybody today in the sacred circle of time, of change. And I would like to begin it in our way with a prayer. Grandfather Chief above the heavenly stars, hear our humble prayer, O Great One. You are the giver of life and everything that comes with it. I'm but a small blade of grass in the vastness of Mother Earth. I ask for your guidance and clearness of vision so I can see the beauty that you have created for us. Bless my hands, O Great One, so I, as your instrument, can do your work on the face of Mother Earth. Grandfather, let all of the seeds unite in the circle today, and may we all come back as one once again. Thank you. Would you like me to begin? I think with the earth being in the severity that it is, that as a grandmother elder of the people, Creator has spoken to me in the past few days since we last talked. I've been praying very strongly, and my spiritual name is White Feather. And when the White Feather came and dropped before me, it showed many things to come, because the spirit of the White Feather is a society in the universe. And I came from the blue star of hope to bring back to the people the spiritual laws and teachings and the healing. Here at the Rose and the Swan, it's about healing healers, and we're all healers. We're all mothers, we're all fathers. And we have forgotten some of the walk and speaking the truth in the way it was given in the ancient times. And so the ancient ones are here today from the universe. The circles have gathered. There are the white-robed ones. There are the blue stars. There is the universal circle. There are the angels, the wee ones, the giant ones. The ant people are the ones that carry the records from the old. And I'm here because I was given that opportunity to be a record keeper, to bring it back at a time now of the healing of this planet. We have to make our changes. We are seeing the viruses, but the viruses are not going to be just taken away. They were created by mankind because we haven't treated the earth the way we should. We haven't listened to her in those ways. Our waters, our earth are in a very hazard way right now, and we have to pay more attention. And this is what it's telling us, pay attention. We have to come back to our circles again. They talked about in the prophecy, the circles of the grandmothers coming back at this time to hold the circles, to hold the councils like it was in the old, and it's happening. And so in that prophecy, we're all walking this at this time. We're all reaching out. We're hearing, but we don't understand it all. So it is our time to open that up and to allow ourselves the freedom and consciousness to reach out to the universe. This is why we're coming together. This is what I heard from the people. And this is what I heard when Sandy called, that reaching out at this time, the Rose and Swan will be opening the beginning of February to take the applications to bring the healers back, to bring them back to the form of the foundation of what used to be the ancients. By remembering, I'm not going to teach, you're going to remember, because it's your consciousness and your remembering. And all I'm here is that instrument to bring to all of you the help and the guidance and the love that we're all seeking at this time. The changes will come in the years to come ahead. You know, it was prophesied in a vision to me years ago when I met the grandmother. She is the one that helped me unfold the remembering. And in the remembering, the year next year is the year is a final cutoff for many things. So we're trying to bring back those records. We're trying to bring back the teachings so that the people can understand what it is here that we're trying to change. And the change is ourself, where there's a lot of confusion out here, a lot of dismay. There is a lot of negative. And in that, that always comes with the change. We know that. As Native, my father was Native Abenaki, Scottish and Irish, my mother Japanese. So I've had the best of the East and the West. And it talked about a blanket that was torn years ago. And that blanket was for me to repair and weave back like Grandmother Spider, to weave the people back together. So everything has been written for us. We just have to be open to it and start walking with it. You know, the responsibilities that we all have to work with at this time is tremendous, because do we, don't we? You know, that is some of the calls week after week, should I or shouldn't I? And I say, where is your consciousness open to? Is it ready? Well, of course it is. If you're making the call, you started the walk, I say. And the walk is to speak truth, to bring the understanding to ourself and our place within our heart. Our first altar is our heart. We've forgotten that altar in many homes. Many of the homes that I go for the children and the mother and fathers is to bring them back to the altar. The second one is our table. We have to come back to the circle of our table. That's where we nourish each other. That is where we come together as a circle, as a family. And that's how it strengthens. That's how it begins. We each have a turn to speak at that table. We are asked by our elders, by our grandmothers and grandfathers, mothers and fathers. These are our foundation. And we have forgotten some of those foundations. And in our Native way, and even in the Japanese way, our elders mean a lot to us, because they're passing down what we're to carry through and follow through. My mother's people were the last of the samurai. It's a strong lineage to follow, but it is a way of life that I have learned to structure and to be able to work off this earth and the universe in the way. We're all here speaking. We've all come from all races of mankind to bring back. And I think that at this time, if we stop and we think of the old protocols and spiritual laws that we have forgotten, it's starting with our elders, starting with our prayer, ending with our prayer. You know, these are things that put into place the remembrance that we once had and needs to be put back into place, because there isn't any one of us that's more or less. We are. And to know that within our hearts is what we're all seeking. And in that remembering, we are looking for that fondness and that likeness and that love. And I think this is an important part, that how love can reach out and touch upon all of us, because our words go forever in this universe. And what are we tapping into in the universe? We're remembering words that we had before within us. It's opening our soul to many doors, things we have to repair, things that we have to repeat, things that we are taking our strengths from in our spirit and making it so that we can walk forward. There is no mistakes to anything that we do. We may have to repeat them because they weren't so beautiful the first time, but in repeating and by walking, we're remembering that we don't have to do it again. We can do it this way and walk together within this circle of life. And today, that is the word. You know, when the white feather comes down from the above, which it has for me many times, this fall in October, when the white buffalo came to me in spirit, and then the day after, the white eagle was the fourth time in my life that they physically came to me and flew in front of me to make me aware we're here, we're at the crossroads, we've got to get moving. It's we've got to step things up and move it forward. We've got to take our responsibilities and know that we're doing it for the good of mankind and humanity. And so we're opening ourselves to that soul, part of ourselves that maybe we have put on hold. You know, it's like drawing the picture of what comes in today. How does one interpret it? How does one see it? How does one put that all together? You know, in our native ways, there isn't anything by chance. When it comes to us, we know the bird is singing a song for us. We know that the ducks came this morning to tell us about the water. The turkeys, 40 turkeys out here, those are the people that will be coming to me and has shown that the seeds are going to be planted. There is bounty ahead. These are healers that are going to be strong. They're going to leave because they have done their work to remember. And these are the things that are being put in front of us that are so strongly given to us right now. It's important for us to not even take the minutest little thing and think it's nothing, because it's something. And Creator's putting it in front of us, the Mother is, so that we can begin again. And so my opportunity today to speak to the people, I am honored. Creator sent me a long time ago to bring this forward. And there are a lot of elders out here that I see that are getting older, that wants to pass the medicine, to pass these things on. But the foundation has to be put in first. And that's why the foundation of the school here is to put the foundation in so that it can be done right and put forward again, like the old ones did before me. It isn't that we're ignoring it. It's time again that we bring this forward. And in that, I can only be so gracious and so loving from my heart that these prayers today are sent out in such a strong way to the universe, because it was chosen for this day. And I thank everybody for the time of being in this circle to share. Hope.
I think that means I'm to speak, Sandy. So good morning, everyone, or good afternoon, wherever you are. I am Anania Ayadele Ajua. My name Anania means she who has purpose. Ayadele Joy has come home, and Ajua is my day name, my African day name, because I was born on a Monday and our day name passed on from one generation to the next. I call myself, I see myself, I know myself, spirit has called me on this planet at this time, this specific time, as an ancient wisdom practitioner and teacher, a leadership coach, and a spiritual liberation activist. That's why I'm here. I'm constantly evolving. Thank you so much, Grandmother Sasa, for reminding us that this is the time. This is wake up time. This is time to move, to shift, to change. And I feel like we are for sure in an evolution. Over the last almost two decades, my purpose has been to support us all in remembering, in particular our women, in remembering our role, remembering who we are, remembering why we came here and what we're here for. And I thank you, Sandy, and the Sarah community for having me back to have this conversation around Death Throes of Patriarchy and what we're here for. You know, we know nothing that is happening right now is a surprise or shock. I keep saying that. The prophecies have said it. It's in many, many different walks and paths and practices and cultures that this has been prophesied. And we are now in this new time, another time, to really bring forth the remembering of ourselves and to make right what might have been wrong, what has been wrong. And I'm so grateful. I'm here in Toronto, so I want to acknowledge that I am on Indigenous land here in Toronto, the land owned by First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples of Turtle Island. And it is my responsibility where I am to make sure that I honor the owners of this land and work in relation with them to make sure that we work together for the betterment of all of us. And so I wanna stop there so that I can allow my other sisters on the call to speak in this circle to speak. And just want to say, I'm looking forward to this conversation to help shift us out of what has been centered as patriarchy and has really held us back. But it's now time. It's time for us to wake up and move and shift and grow. Thank you.
Thank you, Aynania. We'll pass the talking stick to Marley, who will be translating for Nelly now, and we'll come back to you to hear your deep wisdom. Thank you.
Pues gracias por el tiempo de compartir con ustedes un poquito sobre este tema de la caída del machismo. Yo soy Nelly Rodríguez. Y yo soy parte de aquí del staff de la coalición. Soy organizadora aquí en la comunidad. Ya tenemos aquí con la coalición. Yo ya tengo más de 13 años de que comencé a estar colaborando, ¿no?, en este movimiento.
So hello everyone. My name is Nelly Rodriguez and I first want to thank you all for giving me the opportunity to be a part of this conversation about the death of patriarchy or machismo, as it is known more in Spanish. I am a member of the Coalition of Immokalee Workers here in Immokalee. I have been with the organization for nearly the past 13 years. And this is a big part of the work that we do in this movement as well.
Mm-hmm. Y bueno, también quiero agradecer, ¿verdad?, a las dos personas que hablaron, Ania y Sasa. Gracias por sus palabras, porque también son son muy inspiradoras, ¿verdad? El conocer también las experiencias y las opiniones de mujeres fuertes y luchadoras que han estado siempre pues buscando, ¿no? La igualdad para los seres humanos y en este caso más para las mujeres.
So I also just want to thank first and foremost both of our sisters, Ainia and Grandma Sasa, for your amazing words. And it's always incredibly inspiring to hear from other luchadoras, other fighter women who have been creating a world of greater equality in this time.
Mm-hmm. Y bueno, como parte de la experiencia que nos ha tocado a nosotros como trabajadoras del campo y como mujeres latinas, ¿no? Que es, esto ha sido algo que está muy arraigado en nuestra cultura. Yo soy de México y eso es una de las cosas, ¿verdad? Que siempre hemos vivido por mucho tiempo, que el dominio de en cualquier parte de nuestras comunidades, especialmente, ¿verdad? Las comunidades rurales, comunidades pobres, se veía siempre machismo, el dominio del hombre, que las mujeres no, pues no podían hacer ciertas cosas, no podían estudiar, no podían ir a la escuela, no podían trabajar. Esto es algo que uno ya trae en mente.
And so I want to share a little bit about our experience here as farmworker women, as Latina women, and just, you know, I'm originally from Mexico, and the dominance of men is very deeply rooted in the spaces in which I operate and have grown up in very, you know, physical ways, in particular in rural areas, for example. But, you know, women who are not allowed to go to school, who are not allowed to work outside of the home. And again, this is that experience of kind of dominance is one that that many of us have always experienced from the very beginning.
Y desde siempre yo no estuve de acuerdo con eso. Yo fui una de las mujeres rebeldes que ya de los 13 años en adelante yo empecé a querer ver de otra manera, no las cosas que fueran diferentes para uno de mujer. Yo salí de mi casa a esa edad, empezar a trabajar, empezar a buscar ir a la escuela, aún en contra de mi papá.
So, and I have always been my whole life, I'm one of the women who's pushed back against this. When I was just 13, I knew I wanted a different life and I left home at 13 so that I could go to school against the wishes of my father and so that I could go work for myself.
Mm-hmm. Entonces, yo creo que ya desde entonces venía a venir, ¿no? Yo veía venir ya este tipo de oportunidad que tengo al estar ahora aquí. Siendo parte de este gran movimiento y viendo, ¿no? Que sí es posible un cambio. De cuando llegué a trabajar yo aquí a los Estados Unidos, vimos que estaba muy arraigado, ¿no? El poder que existía, el dominio que había por parte de los patrones, ¿no? En la industria agrícola, donde fue el trabajo por primera vez que yo llegué a hacer aquí, era totalmente el poder que tenían ellos sobre mujeres y hombres trabajadores en industria agrícola.
And I, you know, I coming from that moment to now, I think it's been a great opportunity to see the kind of change that truly is possible, even in that time period. You know, in coming to the United States to work in the agricultural industry, I of course saw that here too, there was that constant force of dominance, there was that imbalance of power. Especially in the work environment in which bosses had incredible amounts of power over the workers and in particular over women. And so we saw that, you know, that line continuing in my new experience here.
Y yo creo que por eso pues me aferré, ¿no? A estar aquí porque había esa oportunidad de hacerte ver, de hacerte notar, de hacer que estos cambios no nada más uno como trabajadora lo sintiera, sino que era oportunidad para que más hombres y mujeres también vieran ese cambio, que sí era posible si todos nos uníamos con el sueño que teníamos como trabajadores de hacer esos cambios y que teníamos que estar juntos porque con tanto poder y tanta falta de justicia y falta de ver al trabajador como un ser humano, no era posible uno solo hacer el cambio que estábamos buscando.
And I saw in coming together with the coalition, this ability to be seen, to make yourself seen as a person, to really unite, you know, I feel like we united around this common dream of wanting to see that change, of wanting to combat that imbalance of power, wanting to combat that complete lack and absence of justice and this complete dehumanization of people and this failure that we saw around us. And we really had to come together as a group and unite in order to make that happen.
Mm-hmm. Un lugar donde el ambiente para las mujeres era un ambiente totalmente de violencia, de acoso, que cualquier hombre patrón tenía esa oportunidad o tenía ese derecho de abusar de las mujeres simplemente porque tenía ese poder de hacerlo. Eso yo creo que fue lo que más me empujó para quedar aquí y ver cómo esos cambios que uno soñaba se podían lograr.
You know, and truly the environment of agriculture for women was of incredible violence daily, on a daily basis. You know, women in particular were subjected to sexual harassment, to sexual assault from their bosses. And it was really that pushed me to become a part of this and to seek these changes.
Y ver que hoy en día, verdad, se ha logrado que haya respeto para las mujeres, que hoy en día pues ya ninguna mujer tiene que dejar su dignidad en el campo, que hoy en día ya los patrones saben, verdad, que si faltan el respeto o quieren estar intimidando a las mujeres para que salgan con ellos, a hoy en día ya va a haber una consecuencia para esos patrones, que hoy en día han salido supervisores, han salido gente con poder en el campo precisamente por los cambios que hemos logrado con el programa de comida justa. Eso es para mí un aliciente, es como una inyección de gasolina, ¿no? A seguir adelante y ver en un futuro que si todos seguimos creando conciencia en personas que todavía no conocen cómo era antes la industria, yo creo que eso es lo que nos mantiene, ¿no? En la lucha, el tener ese sueño, ¿no? De poder hacer más adelante cambios en otras industrias y que más hombres y mujeres sean respetados, sean tratados como seres humanos, que se oiga, que se les vea, que se les escuche. Eso yo creo que es la esperanza de un futuro donde el machismo también sea algo en que las mujeres ya no teman al escuchar esa palabra, ¿no?
And I will say that today we've been able to see such an incredible change in the fields. Today, you know, compared to how it was in the days in which as a woman you had to leave your dignity at the edge of the fields when you went to work, today there are real consequences for people who have done that. People who truly held power before are now being held responsible for their actions. And that's the kind of change we've been able to win through the Fair Food Program and the work that we have done. And for me, that has really been an injection of fuel, you know, something that really helps me continue to keep going and knowing that truly, if we can continue to create that consciousness to help educate everyone about the way that things were, the way that things continue to be elsewhere, and if we continue to do that education and to continue that fight, we know that more change is possible, and not just for those of us in agriculture, but in other industries as well. We know we can replicate this so that both men and women can be humanized out of that kind of violent space in such a way that we can, and that in and of itself is what pushes back against this idea of machismo, which before felt like a word that as a woman, you would kind of tremble to even hear the word, you know, because of how much fear and violence was in that. And what we want is a world in which, again, all people are seen and heard and taken into account as full human beings.
Mm-hmm. Eso es algo, verdad, que vemos nosotros como algo que se ha logrado ahorita, algunos cambios grandes, algunos otros cambios, ¿verdad?, que todavía están por venir, pero eso es una visión que teníamos de hace mucho tiempo, y eso en lo personal, ¿verdad?, es algo como que lo que uno veía desde antes, que ahora ya no es como te callas, no dices nada, no puedes hablar, no puedes decir qué es lo que te está pasando, porque ahorita ya hay esa esperanza, ya hay la manera en cual te escuchen, ya tenemos esa oportunidad y vemos a las mujeres en la labor, cómo ellas toman, ¿no?, esa iniciativa de llamar, de hacer la queja, y ya vemos, ¿no?, cómo los sueños que teníamos hoy en día, pues ya se ha hecho justicia, no nada más para las mujeres que están ahorita como dentro de nuestra comunidad, que se ha cambiado mucho la mentalidad de los trabajadores, sino que también es una oportunidad para más hombres y mujeres que ya saben defenderse, que ya tienen una voz, que ya hemos logrado como ese balance, ¿no?, de poder que existía anteriormente solamente para un lado. Hoy ya vemos que se está inclinando un poco más hacia la justicia.
You know, it's, and I think that one way to look at this is by starting, you know, how it was before is you would never be able to speak up. You always had to be silent in the face of abuse. And now we've created real concrete structures, ways for tools for people to be able to speak up and to use their voice and protection for them to be able to do that. And we've seen inspiringly so many women, farmworker women, taking that initiative, you know, calling, being brave, like putting themselves out there in that way. And again, that change, that real bringing justice into that space has been because we've fundamentally changed that balance of power, which changes the mentality of workers in the fields, again, both men and women. And by going to that root of the balance of power, it empowers both men and women to push back against all forms of violence that they're seeing in the fields, because we've been able to fundamentally shift that balance of power so that it leans a bit more towards justice.
No sé si tenemos tiempo todavía.
Yeah, I don't, you know, we don't want to take up too much time, but that's, yeah, podemos parar y dejar tiempo para preguntas si quieres.
Está bien.
Yeah, so we're happy to leave some space for questions and excited to have more dialogue, so we can pause there.
And now you pass the talking stick to RT, right? Whoops. And we'll bring up more RT right now and here. And muchas gracias. All right. And let me just find RT here. There you are. In Sacred Circle.
Oh, here we go. I just wanted to really first thank Nelly for sharing your story and being such a powerful leader for farmworker women. That was truly inspiring for me to hear. I'm so grateful to be able to speak today and take part in this wonderful event and share my beliefs on the multicultural vision for the future. I want to thank Sarah for Hope for allowing me to take part and for Anne Smith for reaching out to me. Just a little bit about myself. My name is Arthi Patel. Arthi means it's a religious ritual of worship, which is done all throughout India. There's many different types of arthis that are done depending on the part of India that you live in. My parents had moved to Jersey City, New Jersey, which is where I call home at a very young age. So this is where I was born and raised. Before I just talk about how important diversity has been for me, I did want to talk a little bit about just my passion for the environment and where that started. So I truly believe that my purpose in life is innate. It's interesting for me because ever since I was a really young girl, nature has been such a powerful movement for me. And it's interesting because Jersey City, I wasn't really exposed to nature as much. Jersey City has been, it's really, you know, a lot of buildings. I was surrounded by so much concrete. And as a little girl, I really looked into the little pockets of green that I found around me. And I was so drawn to those little pockets of green. So the pockets of green were just like in front of my house. It could be a sidewalk and there was a little weed that was growing out. And for some reason I was so drawn to it. Whereas all my other friends that I, you know, they would play with toys, you know, want to play tag or stuff. I always was just wanted to study the plant that I would find in the cracks. And I really, when I look back to it right now, especially as I'm older and in the environmental space, I find that so powerful. It just brings me back to how I feel everyone has a purpose in life. And for me, I feel like that purpose is to advocate for nature in my community, as well as, you know, just globally. My community is very diverse. And so for me, I've really experienced what nature is through a diverse lens. I've taken the opportunity to learn about what nature means to with my Filipino community, with my Hispanic community. And I've done that because for me, nature is such an important part of me, but I also wanted to know what do other, you know, people from diverse communities think of when they, you know, when they experience nature. So a little bit about being born and raised in Jersey City. Like I said, I was exposed to many different cultures, and that really helped me bring a multicultural perspective to any table. Jersey City is New Jersey, New Jersey. It's in New Jersey, just for anyone else that isn't familiar with where Jersey City is located. It truly is a melting pot. It's interesting because in Jersey City, we have small communities. There's a Filipino community, Hispanic, there's Arabic, many different. So it's really wonderful living here for me. This is a big part of who I am, and being able to experience diversity and feel safe living in an environment where there are people of different color, religious, and political beliefs in me is something that I truly value. So that was what I was familiar growing up, as well as what I'm familiar with now. And reflecting back at how white patriarchy has influenced me and impacted me, I really looked back at when I first graduated college and I wanted to get into the environmental space. And I interviewed with a lot of big environmental organizations, NRDC, Environmental Defense Fund, Earth Justice. And what I noticed in each of those interviews that I was in, sitting in the tables, was a lack of diversity. Lack of women as well. I was able to take a tour around the organizations and I just noticed there weren't many women. And this was like back in 2012. So I understand it was like 10 years ago, but that definitely made an impact on me personally and professionally, especially because I noticed now that I am in the environmental conservation space, I still notice there is still a lack of diversity. We still don't have many women in these leadership positions. And what that leads to, I believe, is a lack of, there's less creative solutions. And just to speak a little bit about, I'm the president of Earth Child Institute, and I've been part of Earth Child Institute since 2014. And just the work that Earth Child Institute does is so important for me because it has taught me that it's so important like to, you know, think globally, but also like to act locally. And acting locally is really reaching out to your community. And there's every different community, you're gonna see different diverse, you know, diversity. You're gonna be able to, you have the opportunity to reach out to different groups of walks of life. And it's the interconnectedness that I value the most, which at Earth Child Institute, we strive to work with children from around the world and connect them to one another through environmental education programs. At Earth Child Institute, I've seen incredible work that children have done in Cameroon, in Ghana, and Brazil. And what's really inspired me and drawn me is their eagerness to share their work with other children in countries. That truly is so inspiring. You know, these young children, I noticed like, you know, especially in Cameroon, there's a great little group, they call themselves the Little Angels of Cameroon, and they just do incredible work, really protecting their environment, their community. And Priscilla, who leads the group, she does such a great job with always connecting me through WhatsApp, like, hey, this is what the Little Angels have done. Could you please share it with the children in Brazil? Could you please share it with children in India? And it's just so important to me, like how when you share your ideas, your work, you know, what you've done in your community with the rest of the world, that's when you truly see impact. For me, you know, growing up as an Asian American, my vision for the future, which I wanted to talk a little bit about, is really a multiracial society, no matter where you live in America. We should feel free to be able to grow together, where each individual can cooperate with one another, no matter what their race, gender, religious, political belief is. And they should feel safe for change to happen. I know in many parts of America, right, you know, when I think about America, there's so many parts of America where there are people who are not exposed to different cultures. And therefore, I believe that is crucial to create a space for them to meet others of different backgrounds. Because when we're familiar with different backgrounds, different walks of life, that's when we're truly able to accept one another, where we're truly able to come together to create the change. Right now, you know, we're experiencing so much with COVID, the pandemic, even here in the US, there's just a lot going on that's very hard for people to handle. But what COVID has shown us is that we can accomplish a lot of things virtually. So what I was thinking was, why not take this opportunity and try to create virtual multicultural communities, especially in areas of need. If we bring this multicultural perspective to both men and women, we could start seeing a different world. The way one thinks, acts, and you know, just each day, it truly creates a ripple effect, and that impacts everyone. Like I was saying, in parts of America, there's going back to how there's people that never met someone from an Indian background. They may have never met someone from, you know, even a Turkish background. They may not know the religion. And once you do bring that space to them, the way that they think and act could change as well. I do see this change happening soon. With all the changes that are happening around the world, especially in America, I see an awakening in people. I even noticed some of my own friends, family, ones that weren't so immersed in service before in the community. They now reach out to me and they're like, hey, Artsy, how can I get more involved in the community? Because they see how important it really is to, you know, that to bring service and volunteerism to the community, and they want to be part of that. And so for me, I see this change happening, you know, maybe in the next few years, where I feel if we really open the eyes of many young and older women to really take action and become more educated, we can really create a community of service that can lead to more change down the line. However, in order for impact to be continuous and to be long-term, we do need the mentorship of, you know, women in leadership as well as the elder. It's so important for us to learn from the elder, their wisdom that they share, especially, you know, everything I've learned right now, just in this call. I've learned so much, you know, new things I didn't know before. And I, you know, there's so many young boys and girls that they have such creative solutions right now, but they need the guidance to be able to make that, you know, impact. They need that leadership to be able to just have that confidence in themselves. We need the elders to pass their knowledge and to work together to create that action. I personally have seen what a difference living in a multicultural society can make. And I do think that if we just unite more communities together, that there can be change down the line. So I just want to thank everyone for allowing me to share how important diversity has been been for me, as well as the work of Earth Child Institute, and that how that's really impacted me and the woman that I am today. Thank you.
Wow. You know, this is so amazing, because I've heard from all of my white friends, the majority of white friends and colleagues, how they're not in a multicultural setting. And this is why we wanted to have, and what you have asked for, and what we're all doing, is creating that through Zoom, creating it through this program. So voices that you may never have heard, like the farm workers, like Nellie, mm-hmm. and all that is happening, and for you, and Ayania, and to hear Grandma Sasa, and from the elders. I just want to say a great thank you. And I want to circle back, because you all have stayed with not only in your time, but you have left plenty of time to continue the conversation among you four. And I want to just go back to Ayania, who I think gave up most of her time. But to be able to start that conversation, and for others to be able to just lean into that conversation too. Because you see, not everybody gets this experience where they can hear elders, the young, and a multicultural voices. So, Ayania.
So I want to thank you so much for bringing this true diversity and inclusion together in this circle. And I remember Anne and Sandy in particular, we had a conversation some time ago, and I said, we have to bring the young ones in. We have to bring the young ones in. So to see Arthi is just my heart to see you, my young sister, in circle with us is just, I'm full. It's the circle could close. it's so beautiful to hear your voice and to hear your vision and to hear what you're doing. But also for Nelly, thank you so much for sharing, and Grandma Sasa, thank you so much. I wanted to, you know, in my practice, which is African indigenous practices, and in indigenous practices throughout the world, you know, we talk about what is essential and the essentials of any community, the essentials of well-being, first God, the creator, and then spirit, the spirits, and the elders, and the children. And those are the fundamentals. Everything else comes after that. So what you have created here today, Sarah Hope, is exactly that, is where we need to go. I wanted to talk a little bit about what the topic of this circle is. And as we talk about patriarchy, and I feel that I'm speaking to those who know, I'm speaking to the choir, but I think it's we can never say it enough, you know, to understand that the truth is patriarchy is about male power, regardless of race, you know, whether it's Nelly that is from Mexico, or it's Arthi Filipino, or within Grandma Sasa's communities, or my own background, African and through Africa to Jamaica. Patriarchy is about the embracing and the practicing of male power. And then when we talk about white supremacy, then white supremacy is the overlaying of all of that, which makes it even more lethal. So, and patriarchy shows up in race, faith groups, religion, cultures, people, including women, because many of us internalize patriarchal beliefs that men are better, men are smarter, men are more powerful, and we can become male identified. We can't move without male identity and male directives. And we see what that has created in this world. I say that when we look at what's happening with our climate, with our environment, it's patriarchy and capitalism, one on the same in my mind. And so one of the questions that you had asked, Sarah Hope, when we talked about this death throwing of patriarchy, one of the questions you asked is what influenced my own work, and how patriarchy and white supremacy influence my own work. And I go back to, I will say absolutely, it did and it does. Because when I started Sacred Women International over a decade ago, it was the vision. My vision was to allow space for women to be all of who they are, for the truth, for the wholeness, for the grandness, for all of women to be centered, which in my mind decenters patriarchy. When we, as women, as people, as all other peoples, really stand in our glory and stand in our purpose, we are decentering patriarchy. We are decentering the beliefs and the practices of patriarchy. So I started that organization and started the sacred leadership training from that place, to ensure that women had voices and that women would remember these main questions, which is, who am I? How did I come to be who I am? Am I really who I think I am? Am I really who patriarchy, colonization said that I am? And what is my purpose on this planet at this time? And even more so today, we need to ask that question, ask ourselves that question. And then, am I living my purpose? And I felt my role then was to help in that remembering and to help women to take the steps to live their purpose, to stand in them in their power and to remember their power. And I feel in doing so, we begin to and collectively dismantle patriarchy, dismantle the behaviors and the practices, because it is behavioral, it is a practice. It is not just one way, it is a way of thinking, which is why then women, and even women who identify as feminists, practice patriarchy. Why we see it in our feminist circles, where we see the behaviors of patriarchy, the behavior of male power, even in our own circle and in our own lives as we do liberation movement, as we move forward with liberation. My role at this time on this planet is really focused on spiritual liberation. Spiritual liberation for to dismantle patriarchy. Spiritual liberation for the censoring of all people, and in my space, Black people, people of African descent, people who were stolen from their land and captured and built on stolen land, because land was stolen from indigenous people, from First Nations people. And so when we think, my role, I feel, is this is to bring spiritual liberation of self. Because when we know ourselves, when we are operating in the truth of who we are, when we are operating through spirit, then everything else, for me, everything else can be shifted. And then we talk about activism from that spiritual place. That's the walk I have chosen. And many, 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 many women and men and other persons, all genders, have worked with me over these years, first for their own liberation, to experience what it means to be spiritually liberated. And using that space to shift everything else. I do a lot of political work, for sure. But even within my political work, it's grounded, it's founded in spiritual liberation. I allow my spirit, I allow the divine goddess, I did a divine energy to guide me in the things that I do and the work that I do. And in so doing, you know, I have been able to shift things on a political level, to shift policies and practices that are century years old. Not me of myself, but I've been able to influence and lead that with others, standing on the backs of my ancestors, hundreds and thousands of them who have been doing this work long before me, and all people. And so I know, I am clear that where we are today is in a beautiful place, that there is transformation happening right now, that the chaos that we see, that appears to be chaos, and Gamala Saza spoke to that, this is change. This is change that is happening. This is prophecy that is being fulfilled. And so when I vision, you know, when we look at what is my vision for this world, even in this white supremacist patriarchal world, my vision for the future is joy. My vision for the future is that each of us begin to wake each other up. We get awakened and we wake other people, others up. And in this awakening, we find this inner joy, and our joy lifts the vibration of the world in such a way that we can indeed dismantle patriarchy and create this new world. I believe, I am hopeful. Every time I see a new baby born, it brings me hope. I am hopeful when I hear Arthi. I'm hopeful when I hear Nelly and hear of the changes that she's been able to lead and change and shift the power dynamic. I am hopeful. I'm hopeful that Grandmother Salsa is continuing to teach and share with us, I feel tremendously hopeful. And so I know that our future, the future is about joy. I believe that. And for me, in my work that I do, I will continue to teach spiritual liberation. I will continue to liberate myself. I will continue to support the liberation of my community, of Black people, of Indigenous peoples, of all people, of people of color, and in particular, those who have been most marginalized, and to support our white allies in working with us, working together with us to make changes and to create newness. I am very, very hopeful. I see a lot of potential. I see a lot of potential because I remember when I started this work, you know, two decades ago, it was so difficult. There were so few people, there were so few soul doctors that was teaching. And so people had to go far and wide. Now all you have to do is come on a Zoom. It's so easy right here in your own home. And so that gives me a lot of hope that there will be more and more and more of us. And I'm so grateful. I'm so, so grateful because I know that in defining ourselves and in standing in our own power and remembering ourselves and living our purpose authentically, I know that what that does is that releases us from patriarchy in our minds first, and then throughout our environment and throughout the world. So I will take another break at that and pass my talking stick on for Grandma Sasa to share some more, or another one of my sisters who is gonna share more. Sandy, why don't I pass it to you and you pass it on?
You're muted.
I am muted. Thank you so much, everyone. Inania, spirit is good. I'm going to pass the talking stick to Anne, who is going to lead us to where we go next.
Well,
I love this sacred circle. Oh, you're muted.
You're muted.
All voices must be heard.
And they can't be heard if you're muted. First of all, I'm just so grateful that we're talking about how we can come together as true sisters and brothers in creating this world of joy, because equality has happened. I also just wanted to mention the gift of the Native American talking stick. We've been talking about that. Some people will use the word talking piece and use something else. And that's fine as long as we give credit to the culture and from which it comes. And that is the Native American. It's actually really the Lakota is where I first saw it. And it's a wonderful stick that comes up past my waist and is beautifully decorated. And whoever holds that has the complete attention of everyone else. And they are speaking their truth, their wisdom from their heart. And we all listen from our heart. And so that's why, to me, it's a wonderful spiritual tool that we can even just, you know, I'm going to now open this up. The talking stick is now put in the center of our altar. And I love that the altar is also our heart. And maybe Grandma Sasa, you would like to start, and then Archie maybe, or Nellie, but we're just going to go around and whatever else you want to do before we open it up to the others. And Pat, is that okay? Hello, Pat. You had your voice.
Yes, that's fine. I want to go in my other room and get my talking stick, though.
Okay, go do that. Okay, so the talking stick is here, and maybe I will just pass it on to Grandma Sasa, and then we'll just go right down then to Nellie and then to Artie. Grandma Sasa, hi.
Thank you. My walking stick I'm wearing today because I hold the feather. And to me, holding the white feather is the white eagle. And holding that around everybody. when we come into our circle as women, we always go counterclockwise because that's the circle of life that we walk. The men's are the clockwise, but as women, we're coming in here clockwise to make that energy start moving for us, circle of life. And so the medicine hoop of life that I do twice a year, there's a universal circle of healing. And so we go in and it's beginning of the 90s, it was gone from the patriotic to the matriotic again. And so we're holding that energy. It was given to us as a time from the universe and from Creator to give us back what we've been talking about today. It's our responsibility as women to, when we walk into that circle, to go counterclockwise because that is our natural energy. So these are some of the things here that as an elder, it's for me to remind you to remember again and just bring these little teachings that we all need to remember again. It makes the circle stronger when we do this and we can walk within that. You know, the passing of the talking stick or the feather, sometimes we call it. It depends on the culture that we're coming from, is to speak that truth. And I think this is the wonderful part of today is getting the young women in here and getting them inspired to make movement, to bring forth their voices in the right way. You know, many of the groups that I go to, it's about going in there the right way. If we're going to take responsibility as women, we've got to go in there as the way the matriarchs were given and the Red Troop Society. The society was a very strong society that was taken down a long time ago. When it came to me 28 years ago, the only grandmother that I knew that I brought it to and would speak of it was the grandmother I was with. And in that, she said, it was brought to you to remember because this is the time. Grandmother Mata was her name from the very beginning who started the Red Hoop Society. And Mata means the eyes, that she always has the eyes watching us. And she looks down upon us to help us. She looks within our first altar of life, our heart, to see where we're going with it. And it's always for us women to be strong, to take back our powers in the right way, in good way, not to ever misuse them or overspeak. As grandmothers, we come in, we come in at a pace and a vibration because in that circle of life that they're bringing us back to again, that matriotic system needs to be brought back in the right way. Our cultures, four races of mankind have been given it, but we get to remember again. Part of here is to help people remember again. This is why, you know, when Creator showed me in a vision that the Rose and Swan would be a healing center for the healers, it has to begin at the eastern door. We all have to begin in the east. That is where the sun rises. That's where we meet the day. That's where we can ask Creator for anything we want. And in the evening, when it sunsets, we face the west to give thanks for that day. And in that day, we go to our ancestors. We go to the dreamers. As a dreamer, we do just as much work above as below here to process, to help people, to heal people, to help them remember. So all the processes are coming back and coming together so that we can come back to this eastern door to begin again. And I think we all have it in our hearts. We're all ready. You know, some of us have been shown for years here, the grandmothers and grandfathers were getting us, when we were young, ready for this. And we went to the right elders and stuff to begin again to structure. I was 20 years with Grandmother Nakai. She told me she came 2,000 years before her time to bring this to the people. And that I was chosen to pick that up after her as the medicine. And that's what I'm doing. You know, I sit here quietly behind and many people of you are out there quietly. Now it's time for us to get up and start walking forward and tell our stories. And so I'm very thankful for all the ages here today, because this is what's going to bring us together in that matriotic system again and bring it the way it should. So I'm very thankful for that. And there's many teachings to come. That's why I've been sent here. This is what I'm beginning on that next part of my journey. And, you know, as that record keeper, you know, Australia, I went 3 years ago to be with the Dreamers to open up records of the triangle. The triangle is what we come through. And so those things have to be put back together out in the universe to bring back here to Earth. And we're doing it. Great. So the pins have been put into place. Great. And I thank everybody for all the information, everybody's voice being heard, because we need that at this time.
Thank you so much, Grandma Sasa. And before we open up, I want to make sure that Nellie and Artie have to put into the circle for this incredible composite vision, a multicultural vision. So let's go to Nellie and then Artie, and then we'll have a little time to open it up for others to just be able to chime in and begin to have that vision expand and expand and expand. Okay, Nellie.
Bueno, primero, pues sí, agradecer las palabras de Grandma Sasa. Eso es algo muy bonito y muy inspirador, porque pues, lamentablemente yo no tuve la oportunidad de conocer, pues creo, ni a mis abuelos ni a mis bisabuelos, porque mis padres eran trabajadores del campo, eran campesinos, que por ese motivo migraban, ¿verdad?, de la parte de México donde nosotros, donde yo nací, nacieron ellos, y migraban, ¿verdad?, a buscar trabajar en el campo, a otros estados, y su lapso de vida de ellos fue muy corta. Murieron mis abuelos muy jóvenes ellos, y se fue perdiendo la cultura. Se fue perdiendo mucho de las historias de nuestros ancestros, pero aún así, como quiera, ¿verdad? Uno sabe, uno va investigando y va escuchando cosas que a veces nos recuerdan nuestras raíces y de dónde venimos.
So first, I want to just thank again, Grandma Sasa, for your words. You know, I am, one thing that saddens me is that I never had the opportunity even to meet my grandparents or my great grandparents, you know, where I am, my family, my parents were farm workers from where I'm from in Mexico. And and my grandparents, in order, and it's an incredibly hard life. And so not only were they migratory, but also their time on this earth was very short. They passed away quite young. And I really never had that opportunity to meet them and to hear from, you know, my elders and my own family, to hear about our ancestors, to hear about our history, which was always, you know, challenging. And it's, of course, now still a mission of mine to find those roots and to learn about that history, so that to be stronger for it today.
Pero aún así, como quiera, ¿verdad? Uno va tratando de seguir conservando como parte de la cultura, parte de las cosas que nos han enseñado o hemos escuchado de nuestras mamás, que sí, de nuestros abuelos. En mi caso, algo que era como es mucho de los remedios, por ejemplo, ahorita para que estamos pasando con este coronavirus, que nos quieren curar, vea, con plantitas, con raíces, que hagan té con tal planta, que pongan eucalipto, que limón y ajo, o sea, todos esas remedios que nos dicen, eso es algo que curaban antes, dicen nuestros ancestros, nuestros abuelos, era lo que se usaba antes. Y eso es parte de las cosas que todavía uno conserva, como la comida, escuchar la música de que ellos cantaban antes en el tiempo de la revolución. Yo me acuerdo mucho de mi abuela que siempre nos estaba diciendo, decía mi mamá, esas canciones de la Adelita, esas eran las canciones que antes escuchaban, no como ahora. O también, mucho también, por ejemplo, algo que yo hice y que yo todavía conservo, es como antes te decía que cuando nacían los hijos, uno tenía que enterrar el ombligo, entiérralo en un árbol fuerte, porque esa es la fuerza que va a tener el hijo que tú le estás dando al tener ahí, ¿verdad?, el ombligo. Aparte, no se va a ir nunca de la tierra que lo vio nacer. Yo me resistí a hacer eso. Yo cargué con el ombligo de mi hija, tengo los tres hijos y yo tengo los ombligos conmigo. O sea, yo no los enterré. Entonces, yo los cargo conmigo y eso es algo que yo también quiero pasarle a mis hijos, traer una tradición que yo les digo, mira, yo tengo los ombligos de ustedes. A mí me enseñaron otra cosa, pero yo quisiera que ustedes lo hagan diferente. Yo cargo con eso. Pero como esas son cosas, ¿verdad?, que a veces uno trae consigo y que a veces, pues, no son cosas que se deben de olvidar, porque es lo que uno es, son las raíces que nos enseñan a nosotros quiénes somos y dónde venimos.
And so even with those challenges for communities like mine, I think there is still this incredible effort to preserve and to save those traditions and those lessons from, you know, and so from my mom, I feel like I learned so much about my grandmother, for example, you know, and just to give one example that we've been reflecting on a lot here, of course, now we're in this time of COVID, of the coronavirus, and there's a lot of tradition in our community of home remedy and of taking care of ourselves at home and of building up strong bodies and, you know, with tea, with chamomile, with lemon, with, you know, with garlic, just all of those types of things that even today my mom is, you know, calling me and making sure that I'm drinking my tea and keeping myself strong and safe, you know, and it's those types of things that remain so important, also food and these traditions of food and how we should eat and different recipes or music. You know, I remember my mom always telling me about my grandmother and the songs that she listened to during the revolution. You know, there's this deep history in our country, and telling me about these particular bands or types of music and being like, well, you know, it's nothing like what's going on today. And so just really looking at all those different elements of things that we carry, you know, the tradition of motherhood too. You know, one of the things that folks did in my community is bury the umbilical cord of their children and always said, you know, you need to bury this beneath a strong tree, and that's what's going to keep your child strong. And, you know, I actually couldn't bring myself to do it. I have three children and I have kept all of them, all of those, the umbilical cords saved. But it's, you know, you carry these things, you carry them with you and make sure, because they are what continue to give you strength.
Mm-hmm. Algo que también estamos nosotros, por ejemplo, ahorita los bailes aquí en esta comunidad que tenemos, hay una variedad de diferentes culturas porque pues muchas personas vienen de diferentes países, de Guatemala, de México, de Haití, entonces se combina mucho, ¿no? La cultura, la música, puedes escuchar una variedad de diferentes ritmos aquí en la comunidad. Y eso es algo también que nosotros estamos ahorita tratando de que nuestra comunidad se siga conservando, ¿no? Sus raíces y su cultura. Aquí, por ejemplo, tenemos grupos que se dedican a revivir lo que era la música tradicional guatemalteca con la marimba. Tenemos grupos de marimba que siguen conservando su cultura. Siguen ellos practicando las melodías de marimba, como decimos. Bailes típicos también de Guatemala, danzas que ellos aquí en la comunidad siguen practicando. La música mexicana, por ejemplo, también se usa mucho la música que se baila en México, tradicional como las chilenas. Hemos creado un grupo de mujeres de baile de Oaxaca que en diferentes momentos, ¿verdad?, practicamos aquí en la comunidad, hacemos bailes con ellas. El idioma también. Mucha gente aquí que sigue conservando sus idiomas, que es una manera también de seguir conservando la cultura y las tradiciones. Entonces, eso es algo bien bonito. Por eso siempre es importante crear como esos espacios, ¿no? Para las comunidades, para que sigan conservándolo. Y aquí en la coalición hemos creado, ¿no?, esos espacios para que cualquier trabajador, hombre o mujer, que quieran ellos compartir, hacer una, como, sí, un intercambio de cultura, decimos nosotros, pues aquí hay ese espacio, porque es bien bonito. A veces en la Junta de Mujeres se juntan mujeres que vienen con su idioma de Guatemala, algo otras hablan Canjobal, de México, hablan el mixteco, el zapoteco, el otomí. Dentro de este grupo de mujeres hemos contado estas 7 diferentes idiomas. Entonces eso es bien bonito, porque eso es algo que traemos, es algo que nadie nos va a poder quitar y nos van a poder cambiar, porque es parte de lo que nos identifica, como de dónde somos.
Okay. Translation, and then we'll go to Arty. So,
yes.
Arty, translate.
Yes. And so just to share a few other ways of, you know, that the CIW works to build that multicultural space and that conservation of culture and history, you know, with, you know, we live in a very diverse community here in Immokalee. We have folks from Guatemala, Mexico, and Haiti primarily, and then, and within that, many indigenous communities in particular. We have a group that continues to conserve music in particular and dance. So we have a women's group that does traditional dances from Oaxaca. We have a marimba group, which is the traditional instrument from Guatemala. And in particular in creating space for that language. So you've seen, like, within our women's group, we have women who speak Canjobal, Mam, Otomi. We've counted 6 or 7 or 8 indigenous languages spoken just within our women's group. And so those are just some of the other elements that have helped kind of keep alive those and creating space for that. I think that's one of the practices that the CIW done, is really intentionally creating a space for those things to be preserved. So Reneli, van a ir al próxima.
Thank you so much. And now I'm going to turn this to Artie, and then we're going to we have some questions. But I want to just say, as a white person, it is wonderful to hear from non-white people. Because we get to talk to ourselves all the time, and we have the majority of the sound wave. So I'm going to give it to Artie, and then Artie, I think we have a few questions. If we can get to them, then we're going to have a quick closing where everyone will turn the mics on so that everybody can say in 1 or 2 words how this experience has been for them. And then Grandma Sasha is going to close, and we're going to close right. It's 1:17 now. We'll close right at 1:30, which is the Eastern time. Okay, so we're winding down, but not, I'm winding up, actually, of all this wisdom that is happening. Okay, Artie.
I just wanted to thank everyone for giving me this opportunity to speak about my purpose. And I really enjoyed hearing from such remarkable women who have opened up my eyes and mind even further to the diverse future I see coming together more and more. I have learned an important lesson today to take away, and that is to bring the children of ECI that will allow them to amplify their voices as a whole. I hope to bring together ECI children soon, and I hope you will be able to join me to hear their stories. So thank you once again.
Thank you. Great. Pat, we haven't heard from you. If you have any reflections, and I think we had some questions. And you're muted.
You know, we're going with the flow, and I have no idea what those questions are. So what came up for me, I found my beautiful talking stick. And when you put in the chat room, Anne, about the deep listening, I had pulled aside something that I did, because I'm kind of a professional listener. And I just stumbled across something, and I thought, well, I'm going to read this, given the prompt. It's 7 keys to the creation of a listening field. It's only taken a minute, and it would have been great earlier, but it's a good thing to think about as we are listening, as we are opening our circle and listening to the voices of all of us that have been here today. So I'm just going to read this just for a little prompt. So the first in creating a listening field, because what happens when you create a listening field is it deepens the spirit, the energy of what comes through. It's so literally a listening field. So I'm going to read this, and I think it will deepen our conversation as we open the circle. So the first is to have single-pointed focus and attention, very, very focused. And then also, as much as we're able, to have a full and complete absence of judgment as we're listening. The third is to have an alert curiosity for what wants to show up. The fourth is to have an open space, which we're doing today, with no distractions or interruptions of any kind. And then number five is a willingness to give the stage, the center of attention, to the speaker. And the sixth is a temporary suspension of one's own wants, needs, and opinions. And then the last, which we actually don't have, is a spaciousness of time. There's no rush by either the speaker or the listener. So I just thought it might be, you know, fun to have those little crib notes. And I'm thinking that what, number one, I'd also like to suggest that if you can, Sandy, if I assume we're going to have a gallery images in a few minutes when we open the circle, I hope so. And if we do, if we can actually do what Grandma Sasa suggested and do a counter movement on our larger circle that we're creating right now. So if we can, we can. If we can't, we can't. But the question really that I'll be putting out to everybody that's been here is, how has this impacted you? This has been the most extraordinary hour and so that we've just all shared together. How has this impacted you? And what do you feel moved? What do you feel moved to add to the circle? And I also want to say one of my first things I learned in circle is that into the circle, the energy of the circle, we speak wisdom that we didn't even know we had. So we're gonna, you know, we have to make it short, but we want to hear everyone's voices. So that's what I'm suggesting that we do.
Thank you, Pat. And by the way, in the upper right-hand corner of your screen, if you're not in gallery view, you can automatically go to gallery view. I wanted to say here to remind everybody that we have what we call the after party. So there's going to be a bonus half hour after this call. All of our calls always have that. We ran a little long today, so we want to make sure as many voices can be heard on this call. I have a question to say have been coming through. I think we might have time maybe for one question and then a response, and then we'll ask grandmother to close our circle, then we'll move into the after party, and then it's a free-for-all who will pick up the talking a stick piece. How is that, everyone?
Can I say something? Are you going to have a response from, oh, I muted myself. Whoa, I can't
You're speaking. Okay.
Are we going to have a response from our four speakers today, or are people just going to speak into the circle? I just wanted to clarify that.
I would like our speakers to, whoever this speaks to respond and keep an eye on the time. We have about 5 minutes and then we'll close, because I want to be respectful of our time on the call here and Grandmother Sasa's time. And how's that? Or do you want to,
what we talked about is, in closing, if we could say in a couple words what Pat had suggested, was what came up for you today that is new? Just in a few words.
Okay, so, good. That's fine. Absolutely.
So the question is,
what new has come up for you, and who would like to in this call today that Pat just asked? So who would like to pick up the talking stick? And I'll look for a raise of hands and spotlight you. And actually, I'm going to put someone on the spot here because I see her camera's been turned on. And I'm going to ask Jyoti Saldana to respond because she had a really great question in the chat window that I think clearly is what came up for her. I'd like to say, because in the way she asked the question, maybe you can respond to that.
Thank you so much, Sandy. Thank you, Anne and Sandy, for having this circle. And I just really want to shout out my beautiful mama, Anania, teacher, elder, sister, family for life, who enabled me to remember my power, who helped and supported me in coming back to self. I'm so grateful. And I'm grateful for this circle because it's continuing to remember who I am and my purpose in this life. I just wanna ask the question, how do we bring our men to the table to join us in dismantling what, you know, they continue to benefit from? You know, I've been with my partner for 27 years and he is very much interested in doing the work. So how do we invite them and include them in our dialogue? Thank you, everyone.
That's a beautiful reflection. That's a good question we can all hold. Thank you. Anyone else want to respond?
I'll respond. You know, this walk is very hard for all of us, but me and my partner just had our 50th anniversary, and it's about walking with each other through the good times, through the hard times, and understanding one another. He, at the beginning of this journey, didn't follow the red road like I did, but he got curious, and I invited him to some of the ceremonies. And once he came to the ceremonies, the first ceremony and hearing the drums, he was crying because he remembered. And to start bringing them back to the ceremonies are going to help us with their healing also. You know, he went through recovery and I was his greatest teacher, he says, in helping him to recover and keeping him on that road. You know, life isn't all beautiful. You know, I was 15 when I got married and life has been a long road. But my teacher told me, that my grandmother, that I was to be made old real quickly to begin this journey to help the people and myself. So Just ask him to ceremony, share those little things. Little by little, they're going to spark an interest in them. And they'll start remembering. And I think that's the important part.
One of the things that I think we could do for our series on this, on dismantling patriarchy, is to have one with women and men. Definitely. And for women to speak first, men to listen, and then we can begin to talk about how we can be partners together in this. So this has been a great, great, I think, a next assignment for us, and we can talk about it. But now, in closing, if all of you would unmute, all of you will unmute, so we could hear your voices as we close this. And just in maybe 5 words, maybe 10 at the most, what you would like to say to end this beautiful time together.
Can we? Yes. There goes Marilyn. Okay, good.
No, I just said, are we supposed to say something all at the same time?
Pardon? No, just Marilyn, what is your words? And then we'll go to someone else. Hi, Marilyn.
Hi. You know, I've been around the block so many times that I can't say there was much new. It is always inspiring to see who shows up and what they bring to the party. Their own wisdom. And I always appreciate and acknowledge that. So thank you for the wisdom keepers, and may we all be that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Next, speak up.
My name is Elaine Roman, and I would be happy to just say one thing. I think that when we begin to examine what we think we believe, then we give ourselves the opportunity to see the truth of that belief or whether it is time to let that belief go. And if we do so lovingly to ourselves and to others, then we start to untie the knots that have intentionally bound us to untruths.
Well said.
Thank you.
Holly, did you were ready to jump in?
Just, it was such an honor to hear every single one of you and be with you. And I love how multicultural it is. I wanted to share a very short story because it has to do with something new I learned today again. And what it is that I learned was to really pay attention to the gifts that nature gives me when they're really a sign. Yesterday I was on a walk and there was a beautiful white duck sitting under a bench and there was a white feather right next to her. And I so much wanted to pick up that white feather and something stopped me from it and I didn't pick it up. So then today, right before the Zoom, I went for a walk down to the river and where I live is where the Miccosukee and the Seminole tribes are now and was once a Caloosahatchee land. I just want to add that acknowledgement of the Caloosa people. But there was another white duck at the river and the river was really whipped up and there were white caps and there was wind blowing and this white duck was having trouble getting out of the river. So my partner and I just stood there and watched her and we cheered for her to be able to get up onto our seawall. And this big, beautiful white duck got up on the seawall and she shook her feathers all over and she dropped one feather. And so when I heard Grandma Sasa tell her story of the white feather, I just feel so touched to recognize the synchronicities and the lessons that we're being given. And for me, I'm moving into learning how to be a good grandmother and to embrace my ancestors that are all very white. My friend Betty Osceola, the Miccosukee tribe, has really helped me to accept and love myself for the indigenous person that I am, a white indigenous person. And so thank you all so much.
Okay, well, we're beyond time, so we can extend it a little bit for everybody to sign out, check out in one or two words, and then can we do that, Sandy? And then have the closing blessing and then have the after party?
You're the boss.
No, I'm not.
You're the boss goddess here.
Everybody be able to speak and they haven't. So, yeah. But I think because of time, if
we then we'll move into the after party. Let's do that.
If we could just,
if you can stay
everybody
for the after
who
party.
Needs to leave, so we can close the circle and then we can carry on this conversation. Is that okay? Just to have everybody say in one or two words of who have not spoken yet?
Absolutely, beautiful. Let's, please.
Okay, Abby.
I feel alignment and gratitude and a sense of, I don't know, this.
That's, okay, Angela.
Hi there. I'm just so grateful for the diversity and the wisdom that was shared in this circle. Thank you.
Okay. Who else has their, you have to have your, oh, Sheree.
Yes, thank you. Blessings and peace, everyone. I just wanted to say so much gratitude to all the speakers today and empowering us as women, no matter our age, to step into our divine purpose. I just want to make a note of both what all of you have shared and reminding us, sorry, this is a little bit too much time, but as of reminding us that we are and can go past our fears and that there's just such a strong legacy of workers doing this work. And I will leave it there. And I'm hoping, just one more thing, sorry, that we move our actions towards and trusting our actions against all the things that are happening. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay.
And I want to say, this is Sandra. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Okay. I just wanted to say, especially Anaya reminded me to be hopeful and to share joy.
Great. Great.
Actually, Anne, I want to put something in here before we go. I'm seeing Leah, and I'm wondering if Leah has anything that she can show us before we go to the after party.
Yeah. Okay. Is that okay, everyone? All right. Oh, my goodness.
Wow. Lovely.
Beautiful.
That's stunning.
Yeah.
This is the resonance from everyone here on this call.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, look at that.
That's wonderful.
Looks exciting.
And joyful. Okay. And I'm guessing once Leah finishes that, she can get it to Sandy. And I'm guessing Sandy can have it on the website for everybody to be able to see when it's coming.
And access, yes, of course. This belongs to all of us. This is belongs to everyone here on this call. Thank you, Leah.
My joy.
Really beautiful.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Of the wisdom. It's wonderful to marinate in. I'm so grateful to be here.
Thank you.
So we have a closing of the circle, and then we'll have the informal after party. So Grandma Sasa, do you want to give a blessing for the closing of the circle?
Yes. Grandfather Chief, Divine Mother, we thank you for the blessing of today, the thanking of coming back to the touching of Mother Earth and the healing that needs to take place. Thank you for bringing all the women here within the circle to remember again. Thank you for our learning of our altar of life again within our heart. Many blessings and much thankfulness and healing for this day and every day forward. Aho.
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 Thank you.
Aho. Thank you, Grandmother Sasa. Thank you, everyone. We are officially in the after party where we can continue our conversation much more fluidly. And Aina Nia is blowing us all kisses. She must leave us now for her next priority. And thank you so much, Aina Nia, for being with us. And
always come again.
I often.
Peace and blessings, everybody.
Bless you. Thank you, Aina Nia. Better because of you.
I have to take the time also to thank you because I'm on to my next part. And I thank you for the blessing of this day. And may we all return again soon.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And thank you all so much. Nelly and I are also need to head out. But we really appreciate your time and have just loved hearing and being present with you all.
Thank you.
Gracias,
Nelly.
Gracias.
Love leads the lines of love in circles and angles. Love runs deep like a tunnel with a pendulum beat that touches the heart in many directions. Moving